flagship where we go out and talk to the best people we can find. And, of course, it's always great to have CUBE alumni with us. And I'm John Furrier, the founder of SiliconANGLE.com and SiliconANGLE.TV. And I'm here with my co-host.
I'm Dave Vellante of Wikibon.org. And John is excited. I'm excited. We've got Jim Gantier back. Jim
this is like a tradition for us.
It is. I mean, several times now. I'm losing count. Jim is the VP of Marketing Operations and the General Manager, congratulations, of the mainstream business of ISS. So welcome again.
Welcome back. You were part of the original crew present at creation of theCUBE, and you've been there from the beginning. And you're getting promoted really fast now, so theCUBE is great for your career, and we're happy to be a part of that. Only kidding.
I have a very outstanding team. That's part of the reason.
Of course, you're awesome, CUBE. But anyway, thanks for coming back. Gen 8 servers and last couple CUBEs you were on, talking about market share. You guys are doing great on the growth side. Great story. We heard from Donatelli earlier about this is his third year.
Yep.
And it's just an evolution of the same story, blocking and tackling, just keeping the trajectory going. So give us the update. What's up since our last conversation?
So since our last conversation, I'm sure Dave kind of mentioned this to you. One, when we look at converged infrastructure, it's working. It's not only working, but we're accelerating it. And what you're hearing from us today is the third phase of that converged infrastructure program. And what we call that third phase is Project Voyager. But before I tell you about part three, let me talk about parts one and two real quick. Y'all are with us, and by the way, thank you very much, in California when we announced Moonshot. That was phase one, and there we said we were going to redefine the way that people look at low-energy servers. Phase two is what we wound up doing with our BCS, or Business Critical Systems organization, and we said for Project Odyssey, we were going to redefine the way folks look at mission critical, working with partners such as Microsoft and Linux. And that brings us to today. And the reason why you can hear all the excitement in our voices, after 2 years, 300 million, about 150 customer-inspired innovations, and 900 patents, we're here to announce Project Voyager. And with Project Voyager, we're going to fundamentally change the economics and the expectations of data centers around the world. And the way we're going to do that, you know, like every journey of 1,000 steps starts with the first one. The first step is the announcement of our ProLiant Gen 8 servers.
Wow. So we love Moonshot. So we had a great event there. The energy consumption message really resonated home.
Yep.
And that's a big story here. And it was built from the ground up. We just had Antonio on talking about the services piece. All this work went into it from the ground up. And then the market turned around. We've been talking about big data, that's in there. Talking about server performance, that's in there. Cloud, that's kind of in there. So these servers are kind of built from the ground up, but the timing's impeccable. Mm-hmm. What's next?
Well, I mean, here's the fun part about everything that we've done with the ProLiant Gen 8 product lines. When we say, and we call it, as you can imagine, our mission is to transform the industry, especially the x86 industry, and we're going to transform the server industry. I mean, if you think about it, in less than 100 days, we've made dramatic announcements and improvements to what's going on there. So the reason why you hear excitement in my voice about ProLiant Gen 8 is we said if you're going to transform an industry, you've got to go after your customers' most costly, complex, vexing problems. And the things that popped up in thousands of customer interviews, lots of analyst conversations, and even our own data, is there's three major areas where customers are still having issues. There's way too many manual operations still in the data center, and those manual operations also lead to error-prone issues. There's way still too much inefficiencies from a power and cooling, and also from a thermal perspective, along with energy, and as you and I both know, energy is the number one OPEX issue for every CIO out there, and there's still a lot of way too much unplanned downtime. So what the team was able to do was step back and look at the data center not only end to end but across the life cycle. And as a result of that, that's how we came up with the 900 some odd patents and the 150 innovations.
You guys really recreated this whole new architecture, and obviously we love it because we cover cloud, mobile, and social. The Forrester analyst was on here, and
Mr. Pichera.
He talked about something interesting, but most companies in this space, I mean, servers is your bread and butter. I mean, the different end-to-end use cases, you said mission critical, and you've got Moonshot, high-end flagship, but this is the main sweet spot of your business, the servers.
Correct.
In the data center. Most companies, your competition, they come out with these big flashy launches. You know, we're going to do this, co-host ownership. So you guys did a lot of little things great here. So and that's what Forrester pointed out. So you guys did a lot of little things, point releases, but in combination as an architecture.
Yeah.
A lot of detail.
I mean, that's a lot.
So here's the approach.
How do you market that?
I mean, for us, it's not a question of market. It's how do you market, how do you execute it, and how do you have thousands of engineers wake up every day thinking about it? And the way that we're going to do that is something that we refer to as our proactive inside architecture. With proactive inside architecture, like you would a house, it's a construct for where you want it to go. And as you're building that architecture, as you're building not just ProLiant Gen 8, G9, G10, G11, these are going to be the things that we hold fundamentally true. These are going to be the things that we want to go push those dramatic innovations about. I mean, case in point, let's look at a couple of them. Manual operations. With the innovations that you're hearing about here on the Gen 8 launch, we're going to triple admin productivity. When we look at what's going on in terms of applications, and we all know applications are the lifeblood of your data center, we're going to improve the application performance by 6 times. We're going to continuously optimize it, and we're going to make sure that that information is protected. And then, you know, being an ex-electromechanical engineer myself, one of our favorite ones is energy, power and cooling. We know that that's the biggest spend item that every CIO, or by the way, the facilities person has to pay. With our innovations that we're doing around 3D sea of sensors, and y'all were with us when we did the original sea of sensors, with the innovations around 3D sea of sensors, now as soon as you plug in a ProLiant Gen 8 server, she'll automatically ID herself, she'll inventory herself, she'll say, here's who I am, what you and the rack I'm sitting in, how much power I use, and we've even gone to the little details of making sure that manual errors, like the inability to confuse your A and B whips or power supply whips in the back of the rack. Well, when you do that, it'll tell you, Dave, you wired me up incorrectly. You probably want to switch these two things out, because if you happen to take down one of the feeds, this server is going to go down, which leads to downtime. And then I noticed you had some awesome talent before, Mr. Neri, who leads our TS group, and we work really closely with his team. In partnership, again, that end-to-end optic, because we're the only team on the planet where the TS team or technical services team is actually part of ours, we took all of their information, all of their input, and that's how we came up with Insight Online. With Insight Online, it's the industry's first comprehensive cloud based solution that has all your services, all your warranty, and all of your system status there. So what does that mean to customers? It means that when you have a problem, we'll find it, fix it, get you back up and running faster, 66% to be mathematically correct, and I'm a marketing guy, and then we'll also ensure that you've got 95% first time resolution. Back to a bunch of little things that come together, it's because we took that proactive insight architectural approach as the construct. Look, if you're going to go build the world's most self-sufficient server, you've got to go look at this thing end-to-end and pretty much, across the life cycle.
I was just listening to those examples. Thank you for that. And I was going to have you talk to the audience about unplanned downtime. You touched on it a little bit, but I want to explore a little bit more.
Sure.
Because these servers are highly reliable. They're, 5 nines, 6 nines, whatever it is. But so why all this unplanned downtime? But you sort of gave some examples. So that's because when you inject humans into a system, we screw it up. What about planned downtime? One of the things that Richard Fischera was talking about is planned downtime. Yeah. It's actually a much bigger expense on a daily basis.
Right? Yeah. I mean, Rich brings up a really good point. Most people, when they think about downtime, it's the inadvertent downtime. Somebody did something in the data center, somebody grabbed the wrong drive, somebody, was messing with the facilities, hit the wrong power feed, and things go down. The problem, though, with planned downtime is that people kind of think it's okay. Yeah. We don't think it's okay. We think that even there's a lot of things that we could add intelligence that would help automate and, lower that total amount. Because let's be honest, unplanned or planned downtime, that's
still downtime.
It's still downtime.
Still downtime.
Yeah. Your server's not up, your application's not running, and you're definitely not, facing the audience, collecting checks, or doing whatever else your industry does. So let's look at an example of a planned downtime improvement. A planned downtime improvement is what we're doing with Smart Update. With Smart Update, as you look at the way that people have to find, fix, patch, update various components, that's a lot of, hey, I got to pull this down from the web. I got to go run these CDs. I have to sit there and manually sequence them. I got to watch the blinking lights until it's done, and then I go put the next one in. That could be 5, 7, 10 hours worth of time. With HP Smart Update Manager, it becomes less than 10 minutes. So when we talk about dramatically changing economics and expectations, that's an example of planned downtime that we looked at and said, that's not acceptable. Even that can be dramatically improved.
So you're going to give server admin 30 days a year back.
You've been reading the marketing material. What, that's outstanding.
Well, hey, 30 days. What are they telling you they're going to do with that time?
They're going to spend more of their time on true innovation. They're going to spend more of their time on trying to figure out how do they improve their SLAs. How do they become better partners to the line of business owners, which is the, you know, aspiration target of most CIOs? And they're going to go focus on the things that will help drive more business value, as opposed to spending all of their time, bless their hearts, on maintenance and operations.
So what are the skill sets that you would advise server admins to go get?
I would start with a ProLiant Gen 8. No, I'm kidding. Though what I would advise them to do is, seriously, go look and see end-to-end in your data center. What are the things that are still inefficient? Where do you have manual operations? Where can you improve on the energy efficiency? Where are there still multiple seams? And every time you have a seam in a silo, it's a place where you have to have multiple meetings, which is lost time. So the bottom line is, go look at every single one of those, and then go have a conversation with your partners. Who are the partners that are helping you eliminate, eradicate all of those items, so you can be freed up to go focus on the things that the IT leader wants, the CIO wants, and ultimately your CEO wants?
So this is basically a morale issue, right? And this is a quality of life issue for these guys. I mean, you talk about manual labor, looking at CDs. We all know what it takes. It sucks. Right, I mean, sitting there, okay.
Is that a technical
term?
But sucks time is what it is.
It sucks a lot of time, and it's not good. But people, well, these are tech geeks, right? So mm-hmm. they don't want to be just sitting there, you know, managing all this. Does HP become a luxury item at this point? I mean, what's the competition doing? How do you see the competition? I mean, because you guys then have the opportunity to be that player in the data center that essentially frees up the IT guys. I mean, unshackles them up. It says, go innovate.
No, you hit it on the head. Not only frees them up, the IT guys, don't forget, it also frees up the facilities folks. I mean, we like to talk about the server storage and networking admin. There's also the facilities and the industrial engineering folks. All of those folks spend a lot